If you'll turn your Bibles with me to John, the 19th chapter, we're going to talk about the finished work of Calvary. As we think about the finished work of Calvary, John, the 19th chapter, verse 28 through 30, we're going to think about the finished work of Calvary. The 19th chapter of John, verse 28, 29, and 30. It says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, and said, I thirst. And now there was set a vessel full of vinegar. And they filled the sponge with vinegar and it upon the hops and put it into his mouth. And when Jesus therefore received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head. And he gave up the ghost, the finished work of Calvary. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be here today. We thank you for the opportunity to look at your word. May your word be a lamp to our feet and light to our path. If there's one that's lost, may these be the moments of salvation. But I pray that today as we leave this building, that we know the finished work of Calvary is done. It's over. Jesus has already won the victory. He yelled from the cross, it is finished. Lord, he said to Tetelestai, it's over. And Lord, he gave us victory at that very moment. No longer do we have to die for our own sins. No longer do we have to worry about eternity, that he provided eternity, that he defeated Satan at that very moment that he said it was finished. And Lord, I'm thankful that we have victory today. And if we're a Christian sitting here today and we don't have victory, there's no reason why we can't have victory. When you live in us and that you've forgiven us, and for we have that resurrection and we have taken part in that resurrection, it was our sins that he died on the cross for. It was our sins that drove the nails in his feet and his hands. And Lord, there was one last detail, and today this one last detail has been fulfilled. Jesus has got the vinegar, and it's over. And Lord, I don't know what's wrong with us today, but we must be excited about hearing about the cross and hearing what the outcome and the victory that's already been given. And Lord, we must energize ourselves this Easter like never before. There may never be another Easter because, Lord, you may come back at any moment. You told us to prepare our hearts and minds. And Lord, if there's one today that's not prepared, may they find that preparation. And that preparation is having you in their hearts and lives. And so, Lord, I pray that you'll be with us as we look at your word. And God, may as we seek your will. And Lord, may we receive what you desire for each of us to receive. If we leave here disappointed, it's our own fault. And Lord, I pray that we'll turn our personal feelings aside and start feeling the presence of you in our hearts. And Lord, speak to us like you've never spoken before. Bless you and direct us now as we go further. Let us be careful to give you the glory, honor, and praise. And Lord, if they hear my voice today, they're listening to the wrong voice. They need to hear the voice of Jesus. Let us hear your voice today. And we pray this in your precious and holy name, Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to tell you the greatest thing that's ever happened in society today and the greatest thing that ever happened in society back then is the finished work of Calvary. It's over. It doesn't matter what you're dealing with today, whether it's depression, financial, whether it's hardship or a crisis, whether there's a sin in your life that's sticking out, whatever it is, the answer has already been given, and the answer is the finished work of Calvary. Jesus has died and resurrected and lives today in you and I, amen? And see, the finished work of Calvary, matter of fact, it says in verse 30, when Jesus therefore received vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up the ghost. Now, that is, he gave up his spirit is what that implies. So he said, Tetelestai. Tetelestai is in Greek, and Tetelestai means it is finished. Jesus hung on the cross and said, Tetelestai, 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 it is finished. And today I share with you that whatever you're dealing with, it's finished if Christ lives in you. I want you to understand that as we make it clear, he didn't say, I'm finished. He said, it is finished. You see, I'm sure the Pharisees, with their old smug attitude, the Pharisee says, well, praise God, he's finished. I'm sure without a shadow of a doubt that with great certain that the demons of hell howled with a great glee. Praise God, he's over, it's done. And I am even sure, more so than ever, even his disciples were disappointed as they walked away and they said, well, it's over now. And today, if you're disappointed, if you're like those disciples, maybe you've forgotten that Jesus died on the cross and it said it was finished. And the moment he said it was finished, the victory was won, and that you and I have hope when all hope is gone. God says, I've gone to prepare a place for you that where I am, there you may be also, in John the 14th chapter, in verse 1, 2, and 3. But my friends, may we realize many of them were perplexed and they were fearful. And they thought that he was finished. But he didn't say, I'm finished. He said, to tetelestai, it is finished. It's done. The victory has already been brought. So there's a couple of things I want to give you this morning out of this passage that I think that's vital to us making our march to the cross. The first thing that I would tell you, tetelestai, it is finished, is a servant's word. It's a servant's word. When a servant would complete a task, they would go back to its master and after it's done and said, tetelestai. So this servant was saying, I've done what you've told me to do. Jesus was only 33 years old when he died on that cross. And when he bowed his head and he said, tetelestai, it is finished. He was telling God, I have completed the task that you've asked me and required of me to do. John 17 verse 4 says, I have finished the work of the Father that you have given me to do. He's saying, Lord, it's done. I've completed everything you've told me to do. So Jesus did not die ahead of time. Jesus didn't die as an incident or an accident, my friends. John 10 verse 18 says, Jesus said, no man taking my life for me. The Bible says in Matthew 27 verse 50 says, he yielded up the spirit. Jesus was the only man on the face of this earth that voluntarily died for you and I. So we must realize that this is a servant's word. He's saying, I've completed the task. God, I've done what you've asked me to do. I'm finished with it, and it's done. He did not, have a sentence of death upon his life. He chose to die. He chose to die. Have you started anything you couldn't finish? I'm grateful. The Bible says, now unto him that is able to perfect that which he concerns us, who is able to complete that which he had started. Thank God that our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, finished the work at Calvary. My friends, we must rejoice in that fact because it's a servant's word. It's a finished word. It's a servant's word that says, I've done, Father, what you've asked me to do. But then I also thought about, as I thought about this word, tetelestai, it is finished. The second word that I thought about is not only was it a servant's word, it was a priest's word. Tetelestai was a servant's word and a priest's word. So a priest of the day back then had the assignment that he was to examine the sacrificial lambs. He was supposed to look after the lambs. He had to make certain those sacrificial lambs were absolutely without spot and without blemish. Why? Because those sacrificial lambs in the Old Testament was a picture of the Lamb of God. And my friends, that would take away the sin of this world. So who's he talking about? He's talking about Jesus. And so he was supposed to look after that. So he checked their mouths, he checked their eyelids, he checked their ears, he checked their wool, he checked their scrapes and bruises, and so forth and so on. He would present for a sacrifice what? Something was perfect. Something that was perfect. Now, my friends, tetelestai, it is finished, means it's perfect. So when the priest would get that sacrificial lamb and that sacrificial lamb, he had checked it thoroughly. You see, this is not only a servant's word saying, God, I've done what you've asked me to do. This is also, tetelestai is also a word for a priest word. And my friends, if you've not figured out yet, Jesus Christ is our high priest. He is our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I believe the Lord Jesus Christ was saying on the cross, he says he was a great high priest, and he says, I'm offering up myself. I'm offering up myself. Now listen, the reason he offered himself up was so you didn't have to die. And I'm not sure about you, but I get excited about that because, listen, nobody else has died for you voluntarily. And only Christ did that. And I get excited about that because then we make excuses about what we do and how we do it. And we do such a good job. Any church and any Christian that wants to pat themselves on the back, compare yourself to Jesus before you pat yourself on the back. We don't measure up. This is a priest word. And he says, listen, Father, I'm the perfect lamb. It is tetelestai. It is finished. Folks, I should be moved by the priest word. But my friends, when I thought about this sermon this morning, it's not only a servant's word and a priest word. Tetelestai, it is finished, is also an artist's word. And this is the part I want you to catch on, because this is great for us to understand, but some of us do not understand it. When an artist gets done, he says, tetelestai, perfect. Listen, the disciples couldn't understand the canvas that the Lord Jesus Christ was painting. When the Lord Jesus Christ would talk about the cross, Simon Peter said to him, no, not you, Lord, not you. You're the King of kings and Lord of lords. And Jesus had to say what to Simon Peter? He says, get thee behind me, Satan. You don't understand the stroke of the canvas. What about those two disciples that were walking down the street in Damascus? My friends, they didn't understand the canvas. But it makes sense to us now. I hope it makes sense to you now. We should understand that Jesus, the master artist, is completing what he set out to do. Folks, that was the redemption of our souls. That was his goal. And Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are his workmanship, which literally means we are his piece of art. So when I thought about this tetelestai, it's perfect. I have to think about it's an artist word. It's a word that says it's perfect. It's done. Listen, I am so glad that I serve a Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that has a blank canvas and he is painting us every day of our lives. And we're living it. And my friends, and he's making those strokes, and people don't understand those strokes. Listen, we serve a God of many chances. We serve a God that loves us, that sent his only son to die on the cross for you. And he didn't just die. He didn't just say tetelestai. He arose the third day, and he's alive, and he should live in you. Amen? I mean, come on. You've got to realize we are his workmanship. He's not done with us. He's still painting us. Folks, when he's done with you, you're going to die and be put in the ground. Your old bones are. But he's not done with us, which literally means we're a piece of art. He's putting the last stroke on when he says, tetelestai, it is finished. Well, I thought about even further. Not only was this a servant's word and a priest's word and an artist's word, tetelestai, it also was a merchant's word. That means it was used in business transactions. He paid the bill in full. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful that our bill, because listen, the wages of sin is death. Did you know that? The wages of sin is death. Jesus paid it all. All to Jesus I owe. That's what he's saying. He said, I'm paying it in full for you and I. My friends, there's nothing greater than to go out and eat and somebody pay your bill in full and you get to go home and say, "Woo, it didn't cost me nothing. It sure was good." You know, it tastes a whole lot better when it's free, right? Well, folks, this is free. I mean, he's saying, I have transacted, I have run it through my credit card, it has been approved by the bank, and I have paid your bill for sin in full. Now listen, if we don't receive Jesus, if we don't have Jesus in our life, he didn't pay your bill in full. He gave you the opportunity to receive that bill to be paid in full. It's our responsibility as humans to accept the payment that's already been paid. And so that's the human response. You have the right to reject Jesus and walk out the front door. You have the right to reject him and do whatever you want to. But my friends, it's a merchant's word. It's a transaction that has been paid in full. Well, not only did I think about those words, and I'm continuing to think about those words of this word, tetelestai, it's finished, is it's a judge's word. A judge's word. Listen, when you're put into prison back in those days, they used to put your crime above the door. They'd write on a piece of paper, they'd nail it on the post of that jail cell that you were in, and my friends, they would put it there, and the day that you finished serving your time, they stamped it, and they stamped it to tetelestai, that it's finished. You see, it's paid in full. Colossians 2 verse 14 says this, that he took away the handwriting of the ordinances that were against us. Your sin debt was nailed to the cross. That's what that's saying. When I think about that judge's word, is that it's written above that post. And when Jesus died, he ripped that and said, hey, it's paid in full. It's settled. It's over. He doesn't owe me anything anymore. And today, if you don't have that Christ, if you don't know that Christ, if he's not alive in you, and if he's not real to you, you see, some of you are working here at church. Some of you are sitting here at church. Some of you are just coming to be observers. Now, listen to me very closely. Your debt is not paid in full until you ask Christ to come into your life. And my friends, but he gives us the ordinance of the handwriting that's taken care of if we'll receive him. It's a judge's word. The charges have been dropped. They're paid in full. I can't ever figure out why people do not want to have that realness of Jesus Christ. If I could tell you anything today about the finished work of Christ, is Christ real to you? Or is this just something we do every Sunday? Is this just something we do every Wednesday that we just gather in God's house, we sing a few songs, we throw a few bucks in the offering plate, and then we go home and that's it? We don't need Sunday morning religion. We need everyday religion. We need Christ every day of our lives. This is what he says when he says to tell us that it's finished. And you see, when he did that, he paid it in full for everything in our lives. Now, I don't know why people don't get excited about that anymore, but people don't. But there's another word that's to tell us that reminds me of. And that word is a judge. It's not a judge's word, not just a judge's word, but it's a warrior's word. A warrior's word. It's finished. John 12, verse 31 says, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of the world be cast out. My friends, my battle with Satan is finished. Your battle with Satan is finished. Jesus has won the victory. That's why I say it's a warrior's word, because he's telling Satan, get off. He snatches death from Satan and says, that's mine, and only I control death. And he snatched it from him, and he had victory when he said, tetelestai, it's finished. That's the words. That's what tetelestai means. That's what it means to you and I, that the warrior has fought the battle, and the battle's over. Some of you are fighting the wrong battle in this life. Some of you are fighting the wrong battles, and you need to get on the right battle. You see, I want you to realize, Peter, you never trust a deacon with a sword, for sure, or a fisherman with a sword. He went and took that sword in the Garden of Gethsemane. They came to arrest Jesus, and what did he cut off? An ear. He meant to cut his head off. Did you know that? Thank God that God knew how to pick it up and put it back on that man's head, or there had been four crosses that day. Listen, Simon Peter had the wrong enemy. Folks, we wrestle against flesh and not flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and Satan that's ruling our world today. And Christ has already thrown him out. He's out. But the problem is we've given him audience. We've listened to him. We continue to allow it to destruct our lives. Folks, it's over. It's finished. It's tetelestai. Now, why did I really come here this morning? I really came to tell you something else. There's a couple of things I want to tell you about this. I gave you what tetelestai means. But I want to give you even further. What is finished? I thought to myself, we can say tetelestai, it is finished all day long. But what's finished? What did Jesus finish? We need to hear that. We need to understand that. We need to apply it to the Easter message this year. In the first place, I would ask you to look at verse 28 and 29. That three verses that I read says, in this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, and said, I thirst. Now there was a set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled the sponge of vinegar and put it upon the hops and put it to his mouth. Now, the first thing that I really came to tell you this morning about tetelestai is what's finished. Is the prophecies concerning his death were finished. The prophecies concerning his death was finished. See, I hope you get this. I hope you understand that Jesus fulfilled the old law. Everything in the Old Testament has been fulfilled. So I hope you get this. Jesus, knowing that all things were fulfilled, yet there was one little thing. One little thing that still needed to be done. What was that little thing? What was that one detail that Jesus, before he said to Tetelestai, it is finished. What's that one little detail? You see, he had to taste vinegar because the Bible prophesied it. You say the Bible prophesied it? Sure, it's in Psalms, verse 69 chapter, verse 21. Here is the prophecy that had to be fulfilled, and Christ fulfilled that prophecy in Psalm 69, verse 21. They gave me also gall for my meat, and in my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink. That's where he prophesied that he had to taste vinegar and that prophecy would be fulfilled. That one detail of Scripture had to be fulfilled before Jesus Christ could say, it is finished. Now, I don't know about you, that's amazing to me. You know why that's amazing to me? You see, he's putting this last stroke on the canvas, this great canvas of you and I. And Jesus is now saying it's all done because of one little detail. That's awesome. I serve a detailed God. Now listen, the ancient Egyptians, do you know what they used to say when they built monuments and great pyramids? They said, we build like giants, but we finish like jewelers. Now, my friends, listen to me. That's what Jesus was doing on the cross. He was building like a giant, and he was waiting for one small detail. One little thing. Thank God for fulfilled prophecy. And thank God we serve a detailed God. Now, you're sitting here, and you're saying, Brother Jeff, you hadn't touched me yet. I'm not trying to touch you. Christ is trying to touch you. I can't do anything. And if you're listening to my voice, you're listening to the wrong voice. You should be listening to Christ. Now listen to me. So what's finished? All the prophecies were completed when Jesus died. All the prophecies that led to his death, they are all culminated in the cross. That tells me something, friend. Now listen. That not only is my God a detailed God, that means if you're sitting here today and you're depressed, if you're sitting here today and you're in financial trouble, if you're sitting here today and your marriage is in trouble, if you're sitting here today and you don't know Jesus, my friends, he is a detailed God. And I'm glad he's detailed. One last element's all it lacked. Listen, the same Jesus that fulfilled the prophecy when he said, Tetelestai, it is finished, is the same God and Lord Almighty that's going to fulfill the promises of the second coming. Did you hear me? If he can fulfill it the first time, he's going to fulfill it the second time. And folks, all he lacks is to cross a T and dot an I, and he's going to come like a blink of an eye. He's going to snap, and he's going to be here. And we need to prepare ourselves. We need to be ready when Jesus returns. Folks, are we knowing Jesus? Are we going to heaven? Listen, the Jesus that fulfilled those prophecies can fulfill the second coming. That's what that tells me, and that gets me excited. My friends, don't write those prophecies off. Do not explain them away. Do not ignore those prophecies, because as I stand here today and you sit where you sit today, Jesus is coming back. I guarantee it with every ounce that's in my body. So that second coming is going to be real, it's going to be actual, it's going to be literal, and it's going to be minutely fulfilled as his second coming. So listen, the prophecy that he fulfilled the first is the same Lord that can fulfill the prophecy of the second coming. And so that excites me. The reason that excites me is that this world and this internet and everything else in this world wants to tell you that's a lie. Folks, I believe in life after death. I believe in a Jesus that died. I believe that he's a historical fact that he died. Folks, people sat with him. They talked to him. They saw the crucifixion. They ate with him at the Lord's Supper. He washed some of them's feet. Folks, that's not in vain. He didn't die in vain. He died for you. And he said, Tetelestai, it is finished. He said, I fulfilled the prophecy, every little detail. So whatever detail you're hung up on today, whatever that little iota thing that's going on in your life, he's worried. He's concerned. And he said, Tetelestai to it. It is finished. Folks, we have victory over everything in this world because of the Jesus that lives in us. So the first thing that I would tell you about this word to tell us that it is finished is the prophecies are fulfilled and the second coming will be real and literal. The second thing that I wanted to give you that I learned out of this is his suffering was finished. His suffering. Thank God his suffering is finished because the Lord Jesus Christ said it's paid in full. Have you ever thought of the fact that Jesus knew he had to pay? Have you ever thought about the fact that Jesus anticipated the future? Have you ever thought about how God and how good it would be to know the future? You say, oh, I'd love to know the future. No, you don't want to know the future. How many of you will raise your hands today and say, in 3 years, some child in your family is going to die of leukemia and you want to know that now? Ain't nobody want to know that. But our Jesus did. He knew the future. He knew it was coming. His suffering was finished. A child, listen, he was a child. Can you imagine? Thank God we don't know the future, but thank God he knows the future. He knows our beginning. He knows our end. Jesus knew the future. Matter of fact, it says in Psalms 88, verse 15, I'm afflicted and ready to die from my youth up. So the Lord Jesus knew the future as a child and Joseph's carpenter. Can you just imagine every time that he heard a nail in that carpenter shop being fastened, he knew those were the nails that were going to be driven in his hands and his feet? Can you imagine, can you just imagine that the Lord Jesus Christ, every time he went to the temple and he saw an animal sacrificed, that he knew that he was the Lamb of God? And he knew the Lord Jesus Christ. He lived in the shadow of that cross. Jesus knew the cross was there. Think of dark Gethsemane. My friends, he prayed so hard and he was so distraught. Listen, the reason he was distraught because of humanity. His humanity. Do you know what they said that took place? I don't know if this is real or not. I'm just telling you what people think that took place is that the blood that came from his eyes was his minute capillaries busted because he was under so much distress, so much stress, so much bundled up inside of him that they bust in the Garden of Gethsemane and they started bleeding out of his eyes. Can you imagine that Jesus is going to baptize his soul in hell for us? Jesus suffered agonies. God would look at him like he looked upon sin. He would have to consider him as lawful and as judgment and as all the vials of God's burning wrath against sin was poured into the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you hear the nails being driven? Can you hear them saying and making fun at Jesus and spitting on him? Said, if you're the king of Nazareth, why don't you come down from that cross? Can you imagine him pulling that cross in an infinite period? He suffered the eternal hell that you and I deserved upon that cross. But thank God, it's finished and it's done. He suffers. He suffered to the finish for you and I. That's what moves me today, and that's why I don't understand. Listen, there's no, in Christianity, you've got to understand there's white and there's black. There is no gray. Stop trying to make gray in the Word of God. It's not there. Listen, and some of you haven't figured out yet is I'm for the people that are on fire for Jesus, not for the people that are dead in Jesus. Because I don't want to be dead. I want to be alive. And I want to praise my God. He suffered. He bled. He died. They spit on him and talked about him and beat him and whipped him and took everything that he ever had. He had more agony than any man. Matter of fact, it says in the Word of God that his visage, which means his countenance, was not even recognized as a human. They beat him so bad. And then we sit up here and whine, well, I can't make it to church because my toe hurts. And we whine about what goes on instead of us comparing ourselves to Jesus Christ. Today at the cross, I pray that you'll compare yourself to Jesus, that Jesus finished it all for you. The only problem is you've got to receive it. You've got to accept it and say, to tell us, die, it's finished. Now, the last thing that I would tell you about this word, tetelestai, it is finished, is this. Not only was the prophecies fulfilled, not only was his suffering finished, but the plan of salvation was finished. The plan of salvation was finished. You see, the Bible says in Luke 19, verse 10, says, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save those which were lost." When he died on that cross, all of that was necessary for you and I to be saved. All of that was necessary. Please, 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 please do not try to use two bits of self-effort to explain Jesus on the cross. Your effort is not worthy of what Jesus has done. We cannot work our way to the cross. We can't do it just by our name being on a church roll. We have to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. He had justified forever all those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. He said it's paid in full. The plan of salvation was finished. And I'm not sure about you, but I'm glad that I know Jesus. I'm glad he's my Savior. I'm glad I've got eternity and that I'll never die. And no matter what you say about me or no matter what this world does, I've got a place that God's prepared for me, and it's a place called in heaven. You see, the plan of salvation, when he said to tetelestai, it is finished, he said the plan of salvation's over. And there's one last thing, and then we'll go. It's not only do we have the prophecies fulfilled, not only do we not have just the prophecies fulfilled, we've got to realize the suffering's over. We've got to realize the plan of salvation is finished. But lastly, the power of Satan was finished. The power of Satan. Jesus meant when he died on the cross and bowed his head, when he said, tetelestai, he's saying, now Satan's power is finished. Some of you have given allegiance to Satan and allowed Satan to rule inside of you. And you've got to say, Satan, move out because Christ lives in me. The power of Satan's finished. It says in John 12, verse 31, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Hebrews 2 verse 14 says that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death. And that is the devil. Satan is now defeated enemy because Jesus won the victory. As a warrior, he said, tetelestai, it is done. Now you listen very closely. The power of Satan is finished. Satan doesn't want you to know he is defeated. He doesn't want you to know he's defeated. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ didn't defeat Jesus. I mean, defeat Satan as God. He defeated him in his own spear. He came to this earth and he defeated Satan as a human. He defeated Satan as a human, not as God. But when he said to tetelestai, Satan had no more place. Jesus came out of the ivory palace to a world of woe, right into Satan's domain. There and here, Jesus ripped the crown from Satan and pulled the sting out of death. Jesus won the victory through death. He destroyed him that had the power of death. Today, I want to encourage you, if you're a believer today, to tetelestai. Means Satan has been defeated in your life. If Satan's not defeated in your life, you're the most miserable person on the planet. And Jesus wants you to receive him. He says, listen, I fulfilled the prophecies. He says, I've already paid the plan of salvation. I'm not suffering anymore. And Satan has no power anymore. I don't know what more you would want as a believer at this Easter celebration. The Easter celebration is the resurrection and the death and burial of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In just a minute, we're going to give an invitation, and most of you are going to sit there and say, I don't identify. Why would we not identify with a man that died for us? Why would we not identify with a church that wants to let you know, to tetelestai, it is finished? How many that I want to tell today that's hurting? To tetelestai, it's finished. Jesus can fix and correct anything that you're dealing with. He's very interested in every little detail of your life. That's our God. So the Christmas story. See, I'm wanting Christmas presents. But listen, he said to Tetelestai, it is finished. Is it finished in you? Or are you living a life of torment? Jesus is calling. All you have to do is say, Lord, I want to receive you. I'm a sinner. I fall short. Lord, I genuinely need you in my heart and life to turn everything that's going on in my life around. Or maybe you need to step out on that faith and say, God, I know you and I have you. But Lord, things are going wrong in my life. Why? The victory's won. It's over. We've got things to be excited about. That's why I can't understand churches that want to come and sit and think we're at a funeral. Listen, nobody's died up here. Nobody. We're not at a funeral today. We're at a resurrection. We're at a man that rose for you and I, that died and died for you and I. Nobody asked him to. He did it. And then we sit around like we've done some great favor by making it here today. The only great favor you can do for Jesus is receive him. He says, Tetelestai, it's finished. And if you're not living in victory, and if he's not real to you today, something's wrong. Something's wrong in your life. So I tell you, lastly, before we stand and sing Amazing Grace, Tetelestai, it is finished. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, I bow before you today. Lord, it's a simple sermon. It's nothing hard, difficult about it. What did you die for? To fulfill prophecy. What did you die for? To take care of Satan's power. To give us salvation. And to stop suffering. Lord, there are some sitting right here under the sound of my voice, and they're suffering because they're not living in that victory of the cross. Lord, we have victory if we love you. And Lord, you're calling us not to, it just, Lord, it just gets all over me that people think, oh, I've got Christ and I'm all fired up. Lord, when we see our congregation at 6 o'clock this afternoon, we'll see how many's fired up. You see, Lord, we want you to be convenient God, not a God all the time. And Lord, you're asking to be the God of all time. And so, Lord, I pray that we get on fire for you. That you dying on that cross will change us. And Lord, that resurrection means it's all finished. And Lord, if I'm not living in that victory, let us get that victory today. Let us say, God, forgive, remove whatever sin's in my way so I can live in that victory. You see, God's knocking on the door. He says he stands at the door and he knocks. He says, I want to come in and I want to soup with you. Will you let him in, or is he a stranger knocking at the door, waiting to come in? Soup means he wants to sit down. He wants to talk with you. He wants to love you. He wants to bear hug you. And tell you you're not alone or by yourself. You've got a God that's a victory given to you. So, Lord, it's amazing grace how sweet that sound. There's 10,000 reasons why we should celebrate and not frown. Lord, help us to celebrate today as we leave this place that we have victory in you. And we pray this now in your precious and holy name, Jesus Christ. Amen. The doors.